Is there anything messier than splattering a zombie's brains all over the wall? Why? Yes, there is. The story behind the Call of Duty Zombies game mode. We've tried to simplify this as much as possible, but like the game mode itself, there's a lot of ground to cover with zombie guts. As a quick note, we're focusing on just the Aether timeline to date, as Black Ops 4's new and unconnected chaos story is just ramping up. It begins. This story starts with the Aether, the Keepers, and two entities. One is Dr. Monty, who manifests as sort of a dimensional architect, and the other is simply known as the Shadow Man. Together, the two create a summoning key designed to manipulate the Aether. They use it to summon a perfect dimension called Agartha. In crafting and exploring this dimension, the Keepers encounter Dark Aether. This experience creates two competing factions, the Uncorrupted and the Corrupted. A war breaks out between the two, and knowing they're on the verge of losing everything, the Corrupted hide an all-powerful Aether pyramid on the Earth's moon. They're soon banished to the Dark Aether, where they evolve into the Apothicons. Uncorrupted Keepers hold their place as guardians. September 3-5, meteor shower. The Apothicons know Earth holds a gateway to Agartha. In 5 AD, they send meteors containing a potent material, element 115, to Earth. They hope the Earthlings will someday use it to wage war and consequently open a gateway to Agartha. Spoiler alert, they do. January 15, 1292, the Great War. A great war breaks out in 1292 between the humans and the Apothicons. The Keepers, alongside a mysterious group of four individuals, eventually known as the Primus, defeat the Apothicons in 1299, saving a man named Pablo Marinus. The war is forgotten, buried in the sands of time, and for hundreds of years, element 115 remains undetected. February 4th, 1931 to 1942, rediscovery and research of element 115. It isn't discovered until 1931, when the Germans unearth it near Breslin. Ludwig Maxist, a scientist, hopes to use it to improve humanity. In an effort to begin testing and experimentation in earnest, he forms Group 935. A few years later, Dr. Edward Richtofen joins, though secretly, he's acting on behalf of the Illuminati. In the meantime, Japan forms Division 9 and the Rising Sun Research Facility to study element 115 fragments discovered there. The Germans continue their element 115 experiments, and while their forays into teleportation work, the results also leave human subjects catatonic. The scientists resurrect one of these catatonic beings, hence the undead, aka a zombie. After obeying orders at first, it eventually attacks them and must be euthanized. Running low on research funding, Maxis decides to accept money from the German government in 1939. It's a last straw for Richtofen, who is also concerned over Maxis, considering smaller teleportation experiments a waste of time. You'll recall that the German government wasn't exactly popular around that time because of that whole Nazi thing. Fearing Maxis's decision would cause defection, Richtofen opts to continue the teleportation experimentation without Maxis. Richtofen goes behind Maxis's back and, along with an associate, Dr. Schuster, the two perform teleportation experiments involving humans, not the least of which includes Richtofen himself. He volunteers and ends up on the moon. While there, Richtofen discovers the Aether Pyramid. It electrocutes him, and he's soon driven mad by the voices of corruption. It doesn't take long for him to become obsessed with Agartha. He then ends up in Shangri-La, where he first encounters the Focusing Stone, which is infused with element 115. After a month, he returns to Schuster in 1940, with plans to build Griffin Station on the moon. In the meantime, Maxis's group 935 establishes research facilities around the world, July 18, 1942 to November 6, 1963, charging the Aether Pyramid. On the moon, Schuster kills a rat next to the pyramid, also known as the MPD, and discovers the death causes it to charge. Richtofen soon starts sending humans to the moon as sacrifices, using their souls to power the pyramid. Maxis is becoming concerned over Richtofen's behavior, but he continues his own experimentation. Deep down, he believes the undead will never be able to be controlled. In 1944, Group 935 captures Pablo Marinus, a Mexican spy. They hold him at Der Eisendrache, which has been around since the 1300s. He records strange visions of a corruption many centuries before, but is transported along with other subjects to a Siberian facility in 1945. After he has his spleen removed, Pablo Marinus dies. Who would have guessed? Meanwhile, there's outbreak at one of the facilities, the asylum. Tank Dempsey Nancy, a Marine sent to investigate, survives, but becomes a test subject to replace Pablo. He joins three others at a Siberian facility, Takeo Masaki, Nikolai Belinsky, and Richtofen. The group become known as the Ultimus. Richtofen has brainwashed the other three through these experiments, and they become his peons. In addition to the people at the facility, Richtofen has also been performing experiments on Maxis's daughter, Samantha's dog. Samantha runs to her furry companion, who has been turned into a hellhound. Unfortunately, Fluffy's in the teleporter at the time. Maxis runs in after her, and then Richtofen locks them in the teleporter, sealing their fate. Samantha is teleported to the moon, runs into the MPD, and becomes corrupted by the dark Aether. Meanwhile, Maxis is teleported to the crazy place, where he learns to merge with electricity. Richtofen orders Grove to teleport Maxis to the moon, so he can try to persuade Sam to leave the MPD. Maxis gives her the instruction to kill them all, then kills himself. With his dying breath, he uses his electrical merging abilities to unite with the electrical equipment at the station. In late 1945, Group 935 is disbanded. The Pentagon and Soviets leverage Group 935's data for more experiments, and the Soviets also gain access to Richtofen's diary, which he dropped while teleporting from Der Risa. Several years later, in 1963, Ultimus teleports from Der Risa in Germany to Kino der Toten, marking the first time Ultimus travels through space and time. Remember Dr. Monty, one of the two beings who created the summoning key? He decides to step in, making little edits to the universe in the background. In the meantime, Yuri Savoysky and Gersh, who both started working for the Ascension Group in 1955, start collaborating. Together, they work on a device codenamed Project Mercury through 1963, when Savoysky is kicked from the project. He finds himself reading Richtofen's diary, which causes him to hear Samantha's voice. She convinces him to keep working on the Gersh device, aka Project Mercury, and to trick Gersh into activating it. When Gersh does, it causes a rift that she can use to travel and that sends Savoysky to the Pentagon. On November 6, 1963, Richtofen shows up at the Soviet facility to free Gersh, who is trapped in the Casimir mechanism. After reading his own diary, Richtofen enlists Ultimus to obtain the Vril device from Siberia. On that same day, John F. Kennedy, Richard Nixon, and Robert McNamara meet with Fidel Castro in the Pentagon. There's a sudden zombie outbreak, which is why Samantha sent Savoysky there. March 17, 2011. After transporting themselves through the rift, Ultimus arrives in 2011 at the Siberian facility on the set of a George Romero film shoot. To destroy Ultimus, Samantha unleashes an undead horde on the set. The film's stars help Richtofen get the Vril device, and Ultimus heads back to Shangri-La to retrieve the one thing that can defeat Samantha, the focusing stone. September 1st, 2025 to January 19th, 2036. Nuketown and global destruction. A research group called Broken Arrow needs more Element 115, so they dig for it near a place called Nuketown. On October 13th, 2025, Richtofen, who now has the focusing stone and the Vril device, travels to the moon. Using both of these items, he swaps bodies with Samantha, making him the leader of the zombies and the Aether. Maxis asks the Ultimus members, sans Richtofen, to shoot missiles at Earth. They agree. The remaining members of Ultimus manage to disconnect Richtofen from the Aether, disabling his ability to control it. But Richtofen still leads the undead. By 2035, Maxis will control the Aether and will then return to the moon to take Samantha from Richtofen's body so she can join him in Agartha. Down on Earth, the Nuketown nuke has fractured the multiverse as we know it. Zombies are everywhere, and a man named Samuel J. Stuhlinger joins a group called the Flesh, which feasts on the undead. But this undead flesh consumption causes Stuhlinger to hear Richtofen's voice. The Master of Zombies persuades Stuhlinger to develop polarization structures to mend the rift in the space-time continuum. Also, Richtofen himself can control the Aether once again. After a massive zombie attack, Stuhlinger is one of the few survivors. He meets Russman, a Broken Arrow employee who managed to escape, Marlton Johnson, a Nuketown survivor, and Abigail Misty Brierton. Together, they construct the polarization devices and assume the collective name Victus. Maxis, who had also been communicating with those on Earth through electrical means, is also now corrupted by the dark Aether. He reveals his own true intentions once the group has built the polarization machines. The rifts open up to Dimension 63, and seeing what has happened to her father, Samantha reaches out to the Maxis in that dimension to help her. On January 19th, 2036, Richtofen shows up and tells the undead version of himself to capture Victus for their blood. Victus, now being pursued by undead Richtofen, enters a rift for a new journey. That same day, Maxis destroys Earth. Back to April 14th, 1294, Dimension 63 and the Divergence. The dimensional divergence between this dimension and the one we just discussed starts after the Great War between the humans and the Apothicons in 1292. In this timeline, a rescued Pablo Marinus started what happened during the Great War in 1300, sharing everything he has learned from the Keepers as well as all he knows about Element 115. In the alternate timeline, Primus rescued Marinus on the same date, April 14th, 1294, but we did not hear about him again, except for the strange occurrence at Der Eisendrache in the 1900s. This signals that Marinus's rescue and subsequent documentation was about the time the dimensions began to diverge. July 3rd, 1912 through June 4th, 1918, a new Richtofen and Maxis. In this dimension, Richtofen sees Maxis as a father figure. Group 935 appears earlier in his timeline, and Richtofen and Maxis become members in 1912. On January 15th, 1914, Richtofen encounters another version of himself who hands him some blood vials and tells him they'll help him one day. This other version then saunters back to the other dimension, where he arrives in 2036 to tell the undead version of Richtofen to pursue Victus as they go after the Chronorium, a special book. In 1917, Richtofen and Maxis find Marinus's journal, which tells of an Element 115 dig site in France. A year later, the two visit, and the discovery of this substance allows the researchers to create rifts. Samantha from the other timeline uses these rifts to reach out to this dimension Maxis to ask for help. In this dimension, Maxis doesn't have a daughter. The deposit of Element 115 awakens undead knights from the Great War, who render Maxis catatonic. Richtofen removes Maxis's brain to preserve it. In this dimension, this is where Takeo, Nikolai, and Dempsey unite with Richtofen to create this reality's version of their squad, called Primus, though this is technically a reunion as they work together in 1299. They work together to save Samantha, who is imprisoned in Agartha. When Maxis's brain arrives in Agartha, Dr. Monty steps in, wiping the corrupted Maxis of the other timeline from existence. April 1st, 1933 through July 4th, 1941, Alcatraz operations. In 1933, four criminals unite in Alcatraz: Salvatore Sal De Luca, Billy Handsome, Michael Finn O'Leary, and Albert Al Arlington. The three others, feeling led on by Al's talk of a possibility of escape, turn on Al and kill him. Soon after, Richtofen sneaks through a rift and obtains vials of blood from Sal and Finn specifically. The next year, Al's killers are electrocuted and end up in a version of purgatory, battling waves of undead in an endless cycle. 6 years later, Richtofen shows back up. He meets with the Alcatraz prison guard and convinces him to build a lab under Alcatraz with the help of the Illuminati. A little over a year later, the facility is complete, and stasis chambers are ready for subjects' arrival. In 1941, Richtofen meets Victus, who have traveled through multiple portals to get to the Chronorium. The Chronorium is an artifact that shows the reader only what they need to see. Upon reading it, Richtofen discovers the many timelines and learns about the purpose of the blood vials. This is where Sal and Finn's blood comes in. Richtofen delivers the vials of Sal and Finn to his younger self in this dimension and also recovers the Victus vials. He'll need those to try and save Primus from ceasing to exist, as we'll see in a bit. In the meantime, Victus is frozen in cryo chambers until they're next needed. Primus visits to collect the Victus blood, and Richtofen learns the location of the summoning key. December 14th, 1943. The Shadow Man cometh. Remember way back in the beginning, the entity who wasn't Dr. Monty? Yeah, the Shadow Man. Posing as someone named Mr. Rapt, the Shadow Man works with a reporter to recover some artifacts, among them the summoning key. The reporter visits Morgue City, which is experiencing some strange activity. On April 5th, 1944, Monty, knowing that the reporter is expected to deliver the summoning key to the Shadow Man, writes to the reporter and tells him not to give it to anyone. Over the next few days, the Shadow Man manipulates four individuals to seek vengeance by killing others. The subjects of his manipulation are Nero, Jessica Rose, Floyd Campbell, and Jack Vincent. On April 22, 1944, Richtofen approaches the reporter, knowing he has the summoning key. The reporter attacks him, and Richtofen kills the reporter in self-defense. 3 days later, the four others are knocked unconscious and awaken in a twisted Morgue City. They're tricked into performing rituals by sacrificing people close to them. The ceremony opens up the Apothicon access to Dimension 63. Realizing they've been misled, the squad captures the Shadow Man and traps him in the summoning key. But Primus Richtofen shows up to steal the key. Richtofen then travels to Dimension 2210, an entirely separate dimension, to steal the soul of an innocent Richtofen. The Apothicons destroy Dimension 63 the very next day. Meanwhile, in Agartha, Monty ultimately does return Samantha to Maxis with her innocence restored. Unfortunately, the multiverse paradox needs needs to be resolved to create a universe free of the Apothicons, but they can only do it by leveraging the souls of people who've lived through the fracturing. Around when Maxis shares his plan to secure the Chronorium and Summoning Key, Richtofen realizes he has a connection with Stuhlinger, the zombie flesh-eating group member from the first timeline and also part of Victus. Richtofen decides he'll get the Chronorium through Victus, who must give up their blood to enter the facility where the Chronorium is housed. Richtofen then collects the Victus blood samples from undead Richtofen. Remember that innocent soul Richtofen collects during his jaunt in Dimension 2210? It belongs to Eddie, a younger, innocent version of Richtofen. Monty gives him a physical form. Richtofen also collects the souls of other Primus members, Nikolai, Dempsey, and Takeo, which end up in Agartha. By this time, there are several multiverse fractures where events play out slightly differently than in either dimension. Richtofen is able to collect these souls in these fractures. Primus, now soulless, bring the summoning key to the house. Maxis releases the Shadow Man from the key, and the Shadow Man in turn frees the Apothicons from the Dark Aether. Primus fights alongside Monty against the Shadow Man. They are unaware they no longer have souls, which means they'll be wiped from existence once the fight is over. Once they fulfill their purpose, that should resolve the paradox. But Monty soon discovers that Primus consumed the blood of souls from dimensions that no longer exist, i.e., the blood of Victus, introducing another paradox, as they are still alive. He then sends them back to the Great War, continuing the cycle. Blood of the Dead, Black Ops 4. Events in the Black Ops 4 Zombies mode take place in a slightly different timeline than any we've seen before. Primus arrives at Alcatraz in a different location than expected. Richtofen is there waiting for the Primus Richtofen, but seeing as how Primus is late, it's a sign there could be a disturbance. Richtofen hands the Chronorium over, but encourages the Primus Richtofen to read the book again. Surprise, the game has changed again. The other Richtofen leaves through a rift, and Primus Richtofen tries to leave through a new rift, but is prevented and held back by a zombie outbreak. Here we learn that in this slightly shifted Dimension 63, the Alcatraz Warden was brainwashed. He killed himself to create an eternal purgatory for the mobsters Sal, Billy, and Finn. In this purgatory, if Al Arlington can kill the others, the cycle will break. As far as the blood vials, it turns out that the blood of souls who have traveled through the Aether is now imbued with ethereal energy. Conveniently, Primus Richtofen's blood has enough ethereal energy to open a rift for the Shadow Man and the Apothicons, which makes him valuable and a liability. The Warden and the Apothicons block Maxis from sending signals to Alcatraz. However, he boosts his signal with a sample of Richtofen's aether-rich blood. Primus Richtofen read in the Chronorium that he needs to put his blood through a machine and trigger a dimensional collapse. Only his blood works because it has so much ethereal energy. At Alcatraz, Apothicons have the opportunity to trap Richtofen in purgatory so that he would also never be able to save Agartha. But the Warden didn't count on Al being able to break the cycle of defeat against Sal, Billy, and Finn. This breaks the purgatory cycle and leaves the mobsters free to roam Alcatraz. Al's soul, in the shape of a bird, steals the Chronorium. With Primus threatened to be locked in prison for eternity, Al sympathizes with them and frees them. The additional mobsters held off the Warden long enough for Richtofen to put an end to this pocket dimension. Primus starts the cryo-thawing process before escaping, while Richtofen fuels the dark mechanism with his blood, triggering the collapse of the dimension, but likely killing him in the process. The thawing process opens four chambers, and Victus, that, if you recall, would be called upon when needed. Meanwhile, a fifth cryogenic pod opens, releasing a third Richtofen, who was sent back in time. This Richtofen was sent after the Great War in 1300. After being frozen in a cryo chamber for 640 years, he ends up at Alcatraz to save the rest of Primus and help them escape. Our newly emerged Richtofen defeats the Warden and releases all the trapped spirits within Alcatraz. He then gives Nikolai the Chronorium and tells him that he must keep his soul to defeat Dr. Monty, though Nikolai isn't sure who Monty is. Cryo Richtofen tells the dying Richtofen that the cycle is broken, and they no longer have to keep repeating the same set of events, allowing them to rewrite the future and get rid of Monty. Recall that Richtofen's powerful blood renders him a liability should the Shadow Man and Apothicons reach him. Cryo Richtofen takes the summoning key from Richtofen in the machine and shares that he is not sorry. He takes the vials of blood, saying they'll no longer need him. The group ditches the vials and leaves through four-dimensional portals. The remaining Richtofen dies, and the purgatory dimension is destroyed. It's devastating, since this Richtofen deserves this treatment the least. With the blood gone, the characters don't have to continue living on, and the cycle finally ends. There is so much more to the Black Ops Zombie storyline that we couldn't cover it in a single video, and we haven't even gotten into the unconnected Chaos timeline introduced in Black Ops 4. I've been been Jet Set with a Leaderboard. Thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe.